Greetings again today in that name that's far above every name, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. God is good to us. Give us an auspicious day in which to worship. And we appreciate your presence. You that's listening out in the radio listening audience, most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping during the hour coming up, we can be a real inspiration to everyone. And you take your Bible now and turn to the book of Ruth, chapter 2. We're bringing message number 6 today from the book of Ruth. We have 5 already. And this will be message number 6 taken from chapter 2. Page 316 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. I have a list of cassette tape. I have 266 cassette tape listed that we recorded during our Sunday morning services. You have all kind of messages and a lot of good singing. Now, if you write in and get a list of our cassette tape, we'll send you a list of 266. And after today, we'll have 6 tapes on the book of Ruth. And now these tapes are $3 each. And the gift that you send in helps us pay for our tape and help pay for radio time and our radio expense. And I want you to pray for me and write to me. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is a zip code number. Dear man called me the other day and said, Preacher, I listen to your programs. He said, I appreciate you telling it like it is. Call a spade a spade. Well, we try to tell it like it is to people like they are. And so I want you to listen and pray for us. I was reading in the U.S. News and World Report this past week. You know, some time ago, this charlatanic Oral Roberts implied that God was holding him hostage. And if his followers didn't send him $4.5 million by March, God was going to kill him. Now, that's only one of the big schemes he's used to raise money out of poor, fickle-minded people that don't know any better, that would support that kind of rotten stuff. And this man from up in Illinois, or either Pennsylvania, I believe it was Reading, Illinois, either Reading, Pennsylvania, I forget which, is in the U.S. News World Report. He said God told him that if Oral Roberts got that $4.5 million, that God's going to kill him. So I don't know what's going to happen. Somebody that's going to die one way or the other. You know, we blame a lot of things on God he's not guilty of. And this fellow Jim Baker, head of the PTL club, Pass the Loot club, he said that Oral Roberts is the greatest evangelist on the American continent. That's all the sense he's got. He's in bad shape. He don't know what evangelist is and don't know anything about the word of God in that racket he's in up there in Charlotte. It's pathetic. It's pitiful. And gullible people will follow that kind of stuff and support it instead of supporting the word of God. You may say, Preacher Edwards, I don't like it. I don't care if you don't. God didn't call me to preach what you like. God called me to preach what you need and what the Word of God tells us. And I must be true to the Bible. And these racketeers, these charlatans will dry clean you financially if you don't know anything about the Bible. If you get into the book, then you won't be supporting everything that comes along that calls itself a religious and be carried away with all that kind of charismatic stuff today that's contrary to the Word of God. You better listen to this Baptist preacher. I'm trying to help you. Much of that stuff is coming up in the last days. Beautiful backdrops on TV. Beautiful music, singing, dancing, carrying on. And people get carried away with that kind of stuff. And it's not based on the Word of God. They have all kind of speakers. They had old Mickaroonie. This year, Jim Baker had Mickaroonie on his program up there in Charlotte to tell me a week or two ago. And Mickaroonie is telling how much he loved God and sitting there with his 8th wife, been married 8 times, and had him up there bragging on Jesus. Now that That shows you the kind of racket that's being carried on there. Well, a man like that's got no business even coming to the platform and talking about God unless he gets right with God. Amen?
Amen.
Say amen, oh me one, you know I'm telling you the truth. All right, Ruth chapter 2, and I begin reading today with verse 12. Ruth chapter 2 and verse 12. This will be the message on Ruth number 6. The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings art come to trust. Then she said, let me find favor in thy sight, my Lord, that thou hast comforted me, and for that thou hast spoken friendly unto thine handmaid, though I be not like unto one of thine handmaidens. And Boaz said unto her, at mealtime come thou hither, and eat the bread, and dip thy morsel in the vinegar. And she sat beside the reapers, and he reached her parched corn, and she did eat, and was sufficed, and left. And when she was risen up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves, and reproach her not. And let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her, and leave them, that she may glean them, and rebuke her not. And we've come to this chapter 2. Last Sunday we had brought a message based on chapter 2, and today we want to continue on. Now we notice this man Boaz. Now Boaz was a great man of strength. He was number 7 of the characters mentioned thus far here in the book of Ruth. And he's a type of Jesus Christ. And he's a near kinsman to Ruth and Naomi, especially to Naomi. In verse 1, and Naomi had a kinsman of her husband, a mighty man of wealth, and a family of Elimelech, and his name was Boaz. Now we're going to move on today thinking about how that Boaz discovered Ruth in his field. She was gleaning out there in his field of grain. He owned that great field. He was a wealthy man and a near kinsman to Elimelech and Naomi. And so he discovered Ruth, this beautiful Moabitess woman out of the land of Moab from a cursed land. He discovered her out there in the field gleaning along with the maidens in the field. In verse 5, then said Boaz unto his servant that was set of his reapers, whose damsel is this? Now we brought that out last Sunday. Now let's move on to another thought and notice how Boaz cares for Ruth. He lets her glean among the sheaves in verse 7. He lets her rest in the house, verse 7. And he ordered her to abide fast for the maidens. And then in verse 8 he said, don't go to another field. Now God has a field for his people. God wants you to labor in his field and to serve him in his field. You don't have to go out here and hobnob around every tar baby in the world. God wants you to associate with his people, fellowship with his people, and labor in his vineyard where he's blessing and where the word of God is preached, lest you be deceived. And he said, now you stay fast by my maidens and don't go into another field. You have people today that will sit in the church and never hear what the preacher has to say from the word of God. You can preach to them and you turn blue in the face and they go right out and move contrary to what the preacher's priest had warned them about over a period of years. That happens time and time again. They don't hear the preacher, they don't believe the Bible what he preaches, and go right on out to their merry way thinking they know better than God. And he said, don't you go to another field. You stay in the right field. Now it behooves you as a born-again believer to be sure that you're in the right kind of church and you're supporting the right kind of preaching and a church that believes the right kind of doctrine. Everything that calls itself a church is not of God. You need to know that. You have all kind of different denominations and different churches in the world, and they all cannot be right because they believe and act differently. You need to take your Bible, follow the preacher, and see whether or not he's preaching the word of God. And he tells Ruth, now I want to protect you. That is, he tells the people in the field, the man in charge of all the service, I want this woman protected. Now remember, she's a type of a sinner being saved, and she's a type of the church of the living God, the bride-to-be of Christ. In verse 9, I have charged the young men that they shall not touch thee. Now he said to those young men, you let that beautiful Moabitess woman glean in this field and don't you mistreat her. and don't you touch her. I want her protected. Now God has promised to protect his people. There's not enough devils in hell can take your life unless God permits it. God has his guardian angels to watch over you, and God can and will protect you if you're serving him in the center of his will. And he said something else here. He said, reproach her not in verse 15. I want you to notice that. That's not without great significance. There we find that Boaz said to these men in the field, you reproach her not. You may say, preacher, what is meant by that? He means don't you go and abuse her and remind her of her past life. Let's find out what happened in her past life and you'll see what he meant. He said, reproach her not. Don't remind her that her people were not allowed to enter in the congregation of the Lord for 10 generations. Her people, Moabite's people, God said they could not enter into the congregation of the Lord for 10 generations. Now he said, don't you remind her of that. Don't you remind her, don't you throw that in her face. Don't you accuse her, and don't you talk to her about that. Number two, don't remind her that she came from a cursed people. The Bible said in Deuteronomy chapter 23 and verse 3 that the Moabite's people were a cursed people. That was a curse put upon them. And so Boaz said, you don't need to remind her that she came from a cursed people. Now you keep quiet about that. Then he said, don't tell her that she did not deserve the blessings of the Lord. Don't tell her that she doesn't belong to the commonwealth of Israel and she does not deserve the blessings of God. Don't reproach her about that. Now Boaz is laying it out here to these men in the field. He's telling her not to reproach this woman in this manner. And then he said, don't tell her her father, her forefather was a drunk. Her forefather was Lot. And Lot got drunk. And you know what happened when he pitched a drunk there in the tent and a curse came upon his grandson Canaan. You remember what the Bible said Ham did and his son Canaan received the curse for it. Don't you remind her that her forefather was a drunk. Not only that, he said, don't remind her that her foremother was a disobedient person. Lot's wife was her foremother, and she was disobedient. Number one, she's disobedient to God. Number two, she's disobedient to Abraham. Number three, she's disobedient to her own husband, because God told them to leave the land of Sodom and Gomorrah and get out of there and don't look back. And they were on the way out of Sodom and Gomorrah, and Lot's wife disobeyed the angels, disobeyed Lot, and turned and looked back toward Sodom and Gomorrah, and there she was turned into a pillar of salt. Don't you remind her of that. You lay off for her in regard to her foremother that she was a disobedient woman. Not only that, don't tell her that her people came as an act of incest. Now her people came out of the union of Lot and his oldest daughter. Don't remind her that she came out of a union of incest. Don't you do that. Don't you throw that in her face. Don't say anything about that. Then he said, not only that, don't tell her her people tried to hinder the people of Israel as they traveled through the land. When they start moving through the land, Moses tried to let them pass through their land, and the Moabite's people said, no, you can't do it. Don't you remind her of that. Don't throw that in her face. Not only that, don't tell her her people were cursed people worshiping idols back there in the land of Moab. She knows they worshiped idols. She knows these false gods they had down there. Don't remind her of that. Then don't tell her that her people were a lusty people, according to Judges chapter 3 and verse 29. Don't throw these things in her face. You reproach her not. You men, you don't have to go and remind her of a past life. You know you have a lot of church members like that today. Somebody gets saved, maybe a poor old drunken, a poor old harlot, a gambler, a curser, or maybe sometimes even a killer, a murderer, whatnot. And maybe they get saved, and then some church member turns up their nose, say, well, you just didn't know them back yonder when I knew them, back when they're so mean. You don't have to remind any sinner of his past sins. In fact, it's wrong to do so. Don't throw it in his face. If he's a drunkard, you don't have to tell him about that. He knows that. If he's a curser, you don't have to tell him about that. He knows that. If he's a gambler, You don't have to throw that in his face. If he's she's a harlot or he's a whoremonger, you don't have to throw that in their face. Beloved, they know all of that. And many times, Pharisaical church members want to bring up the background of some poor lost sinner when he comes to know Christ and throw it in his face. Don't you do that. God said, I will forgive you of your sins. I'll forget about them. And when God forgives the man of his sins and God forgets about them, then God's people ought to do likewise. Amen. Don't ever throw it in the face of anybody about their past life. Amen. When a person comes to know Jesus Christ, God makes him a new creature in Christ. And he starts from there. He may have been a gambler. He may have been a thief. He may have been a curser. He may have been a bootlegger. Beloved, don't throw that in his face after he gets saved. He knows about that. You don't have to mind him. And Boaz said, when you approach Ruth there in this field, don't you bring up any of her past. Don't you talk about her people that's under curse. Don't you remind her of these things of her past life. She couldn't help that. And don't throw it in her face. You let her alone and reproach her not. This man, Boaz, is a type of Jesus Christ. And whenever you throw somebody's past life in their face, you criticize them and talk about what they did back when they were sinners, you grieve the Holy Spirit of God. God said, don't do it. If God forgave them, then you forgive them and forget about it and go on and serve the Lord. And then he said something else here. He said, she has promised restoration in verse 9. And when thou art athirst, go into the vessel, go unto the vessel and drink of that which the young man have drawn. In other words, Boaz said, I'll tell you, Ruth, when you get thirsty, there's some water over there that the young men's gone to the well and drawn that water, and they brought it here to the field. And when you get thirsty, you go and drink of that water. That's a type of the water of life. God wants us to drink from the fountain of God. God wants to drink us to drink to our full from God's great stream of fountain of water, the water of life. He said, you go and drink that water when you get thirsty. God said he would take care of our thirst and quench our thirst with the word of God and the spirit of God. Then he said, you eat some parched corn here. We have some food for you to eat. And in verse 14, he reached and gave her some parched corn. And she did eat. I want you to notice this. This man Boaz, a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. This man Boaz, a wealthy man. This man Boaz that owned the field and in charge of the reapers and the gleaners and the maidens and the men there in the field. He said, I want to give you some parched corn. And the Bible said he reached and passed that parched corn to Ruth. This man Boaz did that himself. Now Jesus came where we were. We could not go to him, but he came to us. And he came down and gave us parched corn, as it were. He came and gave us the bread of life. The Lord Jesus did that. Boaz, standing there, handsome, strong, and wealthy, took that parched corn himself. And he didn't give it to the maidens and say, you give this to Ruth. He didn't give it to the man in charge of the reapers and say, you give this to Ruth. He didn't give it to the reapers and say, you give this corn to Ruth. He took that parched corn and he himself gave her that corn. That's what Jesus does for his children. Ground corn in the Bible is a type of the life of Christ. Read Leviticus chapter 2 and verse 14. Parched corn in the Bible is a type of the cross of Christ. There he suffered the wrath of God's judgment, the fire of God on the cross. Planted corn in the Bible is a type of the death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we find him giving her corn, which is typical of the life of Christ, the cross of Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Read John chapter 12 and verse 24. All of this he handed to Ruth. Thereby his marvelous grace and love and concern for this Moabitess maiden. And he calls her daughter here in this chapter. He doesn't call her the Moabitess anymore. He said, my daughter. This man Boaz is taking a liking to Ruth. He sees something in this girl that he likes. And he says, my daughter. And he himself gives her the corn. And she receives the corn. And not only that, as we mentioned on last Sunday in verse 16, he gave her some handfuls on purpose. I like that, don't you? Now those reapers, they reaped out in the field, and they would drop the grain around. And of course, where they dropped that grain, Ruth would go pick up a little here and a little there, because the Old Testament said, now you leave the grain that falls through the cradle and leave a little grain around the edges so the widows and the orphans and the poor people can come in and get some grain for their food. And he told her, said, he told the man in charge of his reapers, he said, you let her glean around close to the sheaves where we stack the grain. There'll be more grain there. Let her glean there. That's the best place for her to glean. And not only that, he said, now listen, reaper, you that's in charge of my reapers, I want you just to drop some handful on purpose here and there. I want you to do that deliberately. Here, I want you to drop a little extra. And then you drop a little more over here. And when Ruth comes along gleaning, she'll pick this up and she'll find some extra here. And she finds some extra there, and you just feed her with the extras. I want to give her something extra. Now, beloved, there's a great truth here enshrouded in the Word of God, and that is she was busy in the field. She was a humble woman. She was willing to go and glean in the field and pick up the fallen grain. She wasn't satisfied to sit at home and Naomi, her mother-in-law, sit around and twiddle her fingers and saying, I shall not be moved. She said, I want to go and work in the field. As she came, and she was very humble. She didn't feel worthy to work in that field. She didn't feel worthy that the grace of this man Boaz would be extended in her direction. She didn't feel worthy. And there she was very humble, bent over, picking up the grain here and there. And while she was working, and while she was humble, and while she appreciated who had been extended in her direction, there Boaz, a type of Jesus, said, you give her some handfuls on purpose. I'm going to tell you, people, God from heaven knows exactly how to give you a handful on purpose once in a while. He knows how to give you a little extra. He knows how to take care of you and your need and how to bless you. But you must be busy for the Lord. You must be humble about it. And you must be willing to labor for what you get. God will never bless a lazy person that's too lazy to serve him. God will bless those that's willing to serve him and willing to work. And she was working in the field when she received the handfuls on purpose. Now you remember that. Had she been sitting back in the tent here in the field or back at home there with Naomi in Bethlehem, Judah, she wouldn't have got those handfuls on purpose. They will come when you're humble. They will come when you're obedient. They will come when you appreciate what God's done for you. And they will come while you're serving the Lord in God's field. You must keep that in mind. She received the handfuls on purpose, verse 16. And then Boaz loved her and wanted her to have liberty. In verses 15 and 16, he said, now, let her go in and out of the rest tent. They had a rest tent there where they went in and rested when they got tired. And he said to the man in charge of the reapers, when she decides to go to that tent, don't you bother her. When she decides to come away from that tent, you let her come. Let her go in and out and find rest when she gets tired. That's exactly what God wants for his people. God wants you to serve him faithfully, go in and out and find pasture. He tells us in John chapter 10, and you can find rest for your soul. And the Holy Spirit of God will protect you as you find your rest in the Lord. There is a rest for the people of God. And so she goes in and out and finds rest, the Bible tells us. And then she has liberty to do so, verses 15 to 16. The Bible said, if the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. You have liberty in the Lord Jesus Christ. Nobody can tell you how you can worship and what you can believe and how you can serve God. You're free. And if God has made you free, you're free indeed. And you're living in a free country. And you can worship God according to this book. And nobody can keep you from doing it. And so he gave her liberty. And he wanted her to be rewarded. Verse 12. The Lord recompense thy works, and a full reward be given thee, the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust. Now Boaz said, I want you to be rewarded. He's a type of Jesus. This Bible has a lot to say about rewards. The Bible says those that work for God unselfishly, those that are faithful in serving God, Those that work for God's glory, they're going to get a reward at the judgment seat of Christ. Those that build upon a firm foundation. Just the other Saturday, a couple of these JWs came by, these Russellites, and I told them, I said, if you'll get saved and do away with that cult and get out of that mess you're in and start serving God, you'll have reward at the judgment seat of Christ. Of course, they didn't know what I was talking about. And I said, as long as you go around peddling your poison doctrine around and working for the devil, God can't give you anything but hell when you die. And you need to realize that. Now, he wanted her to get a full reward. Now, God wants his people to be rewarded. There's not a true pastor, a true man of God alive today, who doesn't want his church members to be rewarded at the judgment seat of Christ. Nothing in this world would thrill me any more than to stand yonder at the BMR seat of Christ and see you, members of this church, stand there and receive a good reward. That'd be reward enough for me, just to see you get a good reward at the judgment seat of Christ. Why does the preacher require you to be faithful? Why do he tell you ought to sacrifice for God? Why do he tell you ought to give to the cause of God and serve? Why does the preacher do that? The preacher does that for your own good. Because there's a day coming when you're going to stand at the judgment seat of Christ and be rewarded for what you've done for the Lord. That's why the preacher does that. He doesn't try to beat you over the head or drive you. He wants you to do it because you love God. And there's a payday someday. And he said that reward would come. And notice another thought, and that is, notice her deeds. In verse 14, the Bible said she was satisfied. I'm glad we can be satisfied in the Lord. Amen. That satisfaction in Christ you can't find anywhere else. After working, she rested at the end of the day, the Bible tells us, as she was careful with that which she had gleaned, verse 17. So she gleaned in the field until evening and beat out that she had gleaned. She didn't want to waste a thing, not even one straw. Everything she gleaned, she's very careful that she took care of it. At the end of the day, she beat the grain out and had some grain to carry home to Naomi. God wants you to be careful. God wants you to be saving what you have. It's a sin to waste and squander away what you have. America, that's one of the greatest sins we have in this land. We waste more in America than people in foreign countries have to survive on. We throw away more food in America than there have in many big nations to survive on. Beloved, it's not right. When Jesus fed the multitude, that is, he told the disciples, don't you waste one fish. Don't you waste one piece of bread. You pick up every piece of bread, every fish is left. And the Bible said they picked up 12 basketfuls. It's a sin to waste and squander away the food that you have. You shouldn't throw it away. You should eat and just cook enough to survive and eat and save and do all you can. And don't waste the food that you have or other things God's given you. It's a sin to waste. Now he said she could go and rest in the tent. And of course he told her that she could pick up the grain and thrash it out. And she brought it forth in verse 18. And she brought forth and gave her that she had received after she was survived. Now we find here that she first took the grain for herself and shelled out enough grain to make out her own bread. And after that, she gave some to Naomi. Now, why in that order? Ruth is a type of the church. The church during this grace age is blessed by the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. Blindness in parts happened to Israel. After the church is fed, after the church is eaten, after the church is grown, after the church is going to be with the Lord at the judgment seat of Christ, then Naomi is going to get her part of the gleanings out of the field. Then will God turn back to Israel. Then will the nation be saved in a day. Then God's blessings will come upon Israel. But first of all, Naomi has got to get some grain for herself. She's a type of the church. And after she's got hers, then she passes on to Naomi. After the church age, then back to Israel. Naomi is a type of Israel. Naomi's a type of that Jew. And could not feed on spiritual things until Ruth had eaten hers. So she ate hers after Ruth had eaten hers. Ruth ate hers first. And then Naomi got what's left. The church today is enjoying the blessings of God first, and then later the Jews will come back into fellowship with God during the tribulation period. Now Naomi saw what she had gleaned in verse 18, and her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. In the end, the Jews will see what the church has accomplished. The Jews today are blinded in part, the Bible says, and they really can't see the value of the church. They are blinded to that. One of these days after the rapture and the church is gone, then the Jews are going to realize then and see what this church meant to the nation of Israel. Were it not for God's people and the church in America and this great nation of ours and the great people we have in this nation, Israel could not survive. She could not survive. She'd be pushed in the Mediterranean Sea by those Arab countries. But because of the God-fearing people of America, and because of the churches, and because of this great country, Israel is surviving today. And so we see here that Naomi, she receives hers, and she realizes then what Ruth had meant to her, gleaning out in the field. Now it dawns on Naomi, a near kinsman is nearby. That is when Ruth says, I want to tell you, Naomi, that gentleman out there, that handsome man that protected me, that helped me gather up the grain and the handfuls on purpose and let me eat parched corn out of his hand and gave me water to drink and vinegar to dip my food in. And he said, that man, he's a great man. And Naomi said, by the way, that man in verse 20 is a near kinsman to us, one of our next kin. Hallelujah. We're getting somewhere now. Elimelech and Naomi had forfeited their land, had pawned their land and left Bethlehem, Judah, had gone down into Moab, been down there about 9 or 10 years, and is still about 40 years to go before Jubilee. In the Jubilee, every 50th year, they could get their land back, but they had 40 years to go. And if they had a near kinsman, a man that was wealthy, a man that could purchase that land, he could buy that land back and give it back to them, and they wouldn't have to wait 40 years. And Naomi thought about it. Wait just a minute. That man is a near kinsman to us. A thought came to her mind. He might be one that can buy our land back that we lost when we went down into Moab. He may just be the man. And he was. Beloved, he was able to buy it, and he did buy it back, as we see later. But Naomi now gets a good thought. That man is our near kinsman. Our Lord Jesus Christ is our near kinsman, as it were. He's the elder brother, and he paid our sin debt and bought us on Calvary with his precious blood. He was able to do it. He was willing to do it, and he did do it. Do you know Jesus Christ today as your Savior? If not, right now would be a good time for you to find out who he is and get right with him. You have listened well. Thank you kindly. Everybody stand to your feet. Our Father, I pray today that you'll take the message and use it. We thank you, precious Lord, for the wonderful spiritual nuggets and truths that we find embedded in the wonderful word. Bless thy people as they cogitate upon the word today, and use it out in the vast radio listening audience, and speak to hearts today in Christ's name. Amen. Now listen just a moment. I'm going to ask David to play a stanza or so of some hymn. And as she plays, if you're here unsaved, if you're here backslidden, or if you're here and you want to join this church, we receive members, or if any other reason you feel like you ought to come forward, we extended the invitation to you and want you to come. Would you come while we wait? I've given you the message. It's up to you now. It's up to you to respond. Just another moment or so. Give me ample time to respond. Would you obey God? That's all I ask you to do. I've done what God wanted me to do. That's up to you to do what God wants you to do.